I'm going to get into all of them today because we'd be here all night. And how long I got, Pastor? Take your time. Oh, he said, don't say that. Take your time. Take your time. Oh, I saw the look back there. That's okay. Okay. When you get full, just go and get up. And then I'll know that I'm done. Okay. Praise the Lord. Tonight, I just want to talk to you just a little bit. When was the last time you heard from God? When was the last time you heard His voice? When was the last time God spoke to you personally in your ear? When was the last time God said, "Where are you?" When was the last time He spoke into your spirit? Was it today? Because many of us say today, God's spoken to us. But we actually spoke to God. Because many of us pray telling God what we want God to know. Not what God wants us to know, but what we want God to know. And we tell Him all about our troubles when He already knows about your troubles. So now is the time we need to get to a place where we need to hear God's voice and understand what He's saying. Because some people say, I can't follow God that I cannot see. So I'm asking you one thing. Close your eyes. It's okay. Just close your eyes. And if I told you to turn left with your eyes closed, can you turn left? So it's all a matter of hearing the word. That's where you get your direction from. If I told you with your eyes closed to turn right, you could do it because you would hear it. That's what God has said. If you hear my word, then obey my word. So when was the last time you heard from God? You didn't have to see Him to obey Him. All you had to do was hear that still, small voice.
Yes,
Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah, in the name of Jesus. Father, we just thank you tonight, God, as I came with this introduction, God, but I'm actually right now, God, to move upon these people, God, upon the ears that made me hear, oh God, upon the heart that they may receive what thus says the Lord, oh God. Put the coals of clay upon my lips, oh God, that I will speak only what thus says the Lord, oh God. Father, I ask you right now, God, move in this room tonight, oh God, for we met the mandate tonight, oh God, where two or three are gathered, there you are in the midst. I know you're walking up and down the aisles right now, God. Meet every need right now in the name of Jesus. Someone came here tonight, God, to hear a word from you, oh God. Let them hear it right now, God. Speak directly into their spirit, God. Clearly and precisely what you would have for them right now in the name of Jesus, oh God. And I will give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory in Jesus' mighty name. And all those in agreement, please say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Now I'm a little loud. I make no apologies because I'm a little loud. Because I was always loud. In the world, I was loud. In the club, I was loud. So I'm loud for Jesus, okay? So you got to turn your hearing up just a little louder so you can get loud with me. So you make your hearing loud so you can hear what thus says the Lord. Amen? Today, I want to walk you back through the book, hallelujah, all the way back into the Old Testament. I want to want you to go with me to 2 Kings. A familiar story. Walk with me back to 2 Kings chapter 20. Beginning at verse 1. It's a familiar story, hallelujah. And if you wanted a title for this, the title of this would be Set Your House in Order. Set your house in order. It is time to set your house in order. For we know not the time or the day or the moment when God is going to break the clouds. Hallelujah. Where will you be? I'm going to have my reader read for me. But just what you do, don't read that. Because some people have already heard this. And I want to get rid of that familiarity already. Because see, some people say I already know all about this scripture already. So if you're hearing this for the first time, then here's your warning. If you hear it, if you've heard this before, then you're being warned again. And if you already set your house in order, then remember this morning. Let's go to the Word of God.
Yeah.
Come on, bring it up.
Amen. 2 Kings, chapter 20, beginning at the first verse. And the Word of God says, in those days was Hezekiah sick unto death.
Yeah.
And the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amos, came to him and said unto him, thus saith the Lord, set thine house in order.
Set thy house in order.
For thou shalt die and not live.
And not live. We just heard the pastor sing a song, the grave won't hold me, hallelujah. So we shouldn't have any worries about dying. But what we find here is Hezekiah is been sick unto death. And the prophet Isaiah has come to tell him, hallelujah, that to set his house in order, for you are surely going to die. Now all of us have our day when we're going to meet with the Maker. This physical body will. But your spirit shall live on forever. For you must understand that you were first spiritual. And then you were naturally encased into a body. The body returns to the dust. But the spirit lives on through eternal life. Is a promise of God. Amen. Hezekiah, we find in this chapter, is sick. Let me give you a little details about Hezekiah. Because we found out that he was a king who reformed. He was not a child that was portraying the same thing his dad. He broke the generational curse, but his dad had started. Because his dad wasn't a very good king. But Hezekiah changed all of that. He removed all the idols. Hezekiah lived in a time then when the very existence of Judah was threatened. Jerusalem was blessed with a righteous king and outstanding Hebrew prophet named Isaiah came up on board to prophesy unto it. But Hezekiah was one of the best kings Judah had ever seen. He was passionately pursued pleasing God, which was what we should be pursuing today, to please God. See, because Hezekiah prayed about everything. So he prayed about everything that went on in his life. Even his sickness. He began to pray for it. And they tell me he was at a young age when he became sick. He became king when he was 25 years old. So even as a young man, he was made a king. Now I've heard of some that even been younger than that. Josiah was, they say, was 8 years old. But Hezekiah sat on the throne when he was only 25 years old. He had a monarch smashed pagan. He smashed all the altars that his dad had already set up. Because see, some of us have some altars in our lives. We have some pagan things in our lives that we don't even realize we have. When was the last time you checked out your home? For some of the things and where they came from, what they meant. Especially if you ever lived in a place called Hawaii. They love to sell these little... Okay, who here from Hawaii? I'm not needing to offend anyone. I'm just saying, know where your stuff come from. Because when you place it in your house, you never know what else you're placing in your house. Because it's time now to set your house in order. In order to set your house in order, you might have to remove some things from your home. You might have to move away from some friends who mean you no good. I always tell those who go to covenant, if your friends are not promoting you, you need to get some new friends. Because if they're always trying to tear you down, telling you what your dreams don't even work, don't even worry about it. That doesn't work. That's not going to happen. But if God gave you a dream and God gave you things that you should be doing, don't let someone else talk you out of your dreams. Yes, yes, yes. Amen. Set your house in order. Glory to God. Get back to prayer.
Amen.
Get back to daily worship. Yes. See, you don't have to come here to worship God. You can put music on in your home and begin to worship right there in the midst. Because God is omnipresent. Hallelujah. He's everywhere. So you don't have to be demanding to come to church, but don't forsake the assembling of yourself. But in your own home, where you need to set the order, begin to read the Word of God. Prepare yourself to come in to the house of the Lord. Amen. Preparation starts at home. Setting yourself in order. See, Hezekiah set himself in order. He knew when he got sick who he should pray to. The great physician. Amen. He knew he should pray to God.
Glory, glory.
But I think it's our belief sometimes. Our belief gets us in trouble. Because do we really believe God can heal us? Do we really believe that? Do we believe he's a healer? Do we believe he's a deliverer? Do we believe he can set you free? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And without faith, it's impossible to please God. But Hezekiah came to this point where he was actually sick, hallelujah. And he told him that Isaiah came and told him to set his house in order. See, many of us read this passage looking at it from the physical aspect. We look at a physical house. But I believe we should look at our spiritual house. Amen. What's on the inside of you need to come up on the outside. You can't keep feeding the outside without feeding the inside. You are starving the inside and started blowing up on the outside. The spiritual man is hungry. He wants to be fed. The only cereal he will eat is the word of God. So we have to prepare ourselves by beginning to read, understand the word of God. Rightly divided. Every day, because we have put the show on for too long. As we just heard in the news, where a pastor was and his congregation were killed right in the church. It's not even safe in the church no more. The enemy will come right up in the church. He comes with some of us sometimes. He sit on one side. You ever seen that? And then we sit there with indecision, like it's taking too long. What is this pastor talking about? I don't want to hear the word today. It's taking too long. I ain't ate yet. What it is to eat? Our minds go in all different directions besides the direction that God would have us to be. Just imagine if all of us had to come in here with our focus on God. If we had came here on one accord. See, it wouldn't matter about the numbers, see, because God don't work with numbers. Because he said we're two or three are gathered.
Yes.
That's all I need is two or three gathered together. And he's sitting right there in the midst. This is how we begin to set our house in order. Come to the house of God already prepared. Because it starts at home. Our children, hallelujah, need to see us praising God in our home. They need to see us reading our word in our homes. They need to see us, hallelujah, doing the works of the Lord in our homes, hallelujah. Setting our house in order. Go ahead and read from it.
Then he turned his face to the wall,
mm-hmm,
and prayed unto the Lord, saying, I beseech thee, O Lord,
mm-hmm,
remember now how I have walked before thee in truth, and with a pure heart, and have done that which is good in thy sight.
Mm-hmm.
And Hezekiah wept sore.
He wept sore. Hezekiah reminded God of all the things, just like we do. We're in a hurry to remind God of what he has done, of what we have done. Lord, I prayed all night long, God. To save my son, hallelujah. God, I did all these things. I did that was true, God. I did what you told me to do, God. Did you really do it? Or are you really saying that you did? Because sometimes our mouth overloads us. We say things that we really haven't done. Especially when we think we're in the presence of God. But guess what? God has already saw that. He saw what you didn't do. Even when you was doing your worst, God saw it. The word that's coming tonight is for all of us. All of us. Set your house in order. quit playing house and begin to set your house in order. Because the enemy is coming, hallelujah, all into the house of God, killing the innocent in the midst of it, hallelujah. I know you read the story, hallelujah. Some of us are even upset about what happened there. And I want you to pray for the pastors everywhere. Because it's not even safe in making us really take a look at who comes in and who goes out. And it really shouldn't be like that in the house of God. But I tell you what, as long as your house is set in order, God will keep you covered. Amen. God will keep you covered. But I still wasn't disturbed by the fact that he went right in, set among believers, and then killed them all. Which leads me to believe that tomorrow is not promised to none of us. So why would we want to even play Russian roulette with our lives? Why would we want to sit here and act like we got it going on when we're deep in the things that we shouldn't even be in? We're doing things that are against the word of God. Not y'all. Y'all good people. Y'all don't do anything. Not y'all. Let me just say one more thing about the pastor that was killed the other day. The word that came from, if I could just share this, it was written on the day, it says, from the NAACP president, he said, there is no greater coward than a criminal who enters a house of God, slaughters innocent people. It's time to set our house in order. Because you don't know, will you live to make tomorrow? I didn't come in with a frightening message. I came in to let you know that your spiritual house needs to be set in order. It's been disarrayed too long. Clothes been thrown all around in there. We got other people's clothes in our house. It's time to set your house in order. To do what God has called you to do. And not be listening to what someone else has labeled you as. What someone has said that you are. Your pastor needs help. So you need to set your house in order so that you may be able and be ready and be available to help. Because if your house is in order, how can you set God's house in order? Some of us are still sick. But we got to learn how to set our house in order. Go ahead and read for me.
And it came to pass, before Isaiah was gone out into the middle court, that the word of the Lord came to him, saying, turn again and tell Hezekiah, the captain of my people, thus say the Lord, the God of David, thy father, I have heard thy prayer and have seen thy tears. Behold, I will heal thee. On the third day, thou shalt go up unto the house of the Lord, and I will add unto thee 15 years, and I will deliver thee and this city out of the hand of the king of Assyria, and I will defend this city for my own sake.
For my own sake.
And for my servant David's sake.
For his sake. You ought to be shouting about that.
Hallelujah.
Can you shout about 15 years that the Lord added unto us? Who else could have added 15 years to a man's life? Who else could have done that other than God? See, when you hear the voice of God, when you know God is in your life, you know when he said he's going to add 15 years, he's going to add. Number five is the number of grace. I say grace was abounding in his life, and he was God is ready to heal you. Not of your physical sickness, but of your spiritual sickness. God is ready to heal and add unto your life. Well, you know the statistic today, most people don't live past 70 years old. But the thing that separates us from most is that we serve a God who said that we would have eternal life. So it's not about this temporary location that we're in, this temporary world that we're in. It's about going to our mansion, which he said, I made a place for you, a mansion, not a little house, but a mansion.
Yep.
Prepared a mansion for you.
Yep.
And where you be, I'll be there also.
Yes. That's right.
But you gotta set your house in order right here. Because your belief is really being affected by what you are doing. Your actions, hallelujah. What are you doing today, hallelujah? Have you become like Hezekiah? Hey, do the prophet Isaiah need to come to your house? What does God need to do to get your attention? Does he need to swallow you up? Does he? Does he need to put you in the burning fire? Does he? Does he need to put you in the lion's den? Oh, that's not me. Oh, y'all got it going on, right? But teach me how to keep it like that. Because every day you wake up, there's a different thing that's coming your way. Because the enemy doesn't stop just because you got saved. The enemy doesn't stop bothering you just because you got saved. If you want to go and take this ministry to another level and to the worldwide, that's what I always say, Pastor. It's not just about right here. Because the more you get on that social media, the more you get out there, at least say something good. I told him the other day, at least put a word out there. At least put a scripture out there. At least text a scripture. At least email somebody a word of God. Don't always be the one who's gossiping about somebody. At least put a word of God out there. Our children are suffering because we're saying things. I told him too, you know, words have a way of still impacting us. You ever heard somebody say something bad about you and it's still lingers around. You still kind of hear that word every now and then. Your mama told you, well, you're going to be nothing. Your daddy told you, you was going to be like me. They always told me I was going to be like my dad. But I already outlived my dad. He didn't make it. So there's no such thing as I'm going to be like him. Because of Dana, I'm different. That's DNA, I'm sorry. For y'all, that's dang on. Real business. DNA. Praise God. Isaiah, let me tell you a little bit about Isaiah. Isaiah validated what was said over in 2 Kings. If you go to Isaiah chapter 38, he said, in those days, Hezekiah, sick unto death, and Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amos, came unto him and said unto him, thus said the Lord, set thy house in order. For thou shalt die and not live. Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and prayed unto the Lord. A key word is that turning your face to the wall. Mm-hmm. When you turn your face to the wall, you turn your face away from people. Mm-hmm. You might have to get in your closet and begin to pray to the Lord without the distractions of people, because people can be a distraction. Not only people, hallelujah, but there are other things that can be a distraction in your life. Your cell phone can be a distraction for you. Your cell phone, you might want to turn that off when it comes time to pray. You might want to move your iPad to off position. Oh. Okay, so I see you looking out there. Turn my cell phone off. Really? But in order to set your house in order, you're going to have to change some things in your life. You can't keep on going the same way, doing the same thing, and expecting a different result. Because somebody told me that was called insanity. To do the same thing and expect a different result. It doesn't work like that. I'm asking you and I'm telling you and I'm beseeching you to set your house in order. Change the way you do things. If you've been coming to church once a week, start coming twice a week. If you've been praying once a week, start praying twice a week. Form a different habit, hallelujah. Set your house in order. If you've been skipping school, stop going to school. If you ain't been doing your homework, start doing your homework. If you ain't been praying, start praying. It starts somewhere. We have to form a habit as human beings. Some of us have some old habits that need to be broken. Need to be changed. Somebody told me it takes 30 days now to change a habit. But if we be consistent at what we do to change it, and we be committed to change it, it will change. But we have gotten stuck. I've done something so much for almost 50 years. Oh, telling how old I am. It's been a long time since I've changed it, but it works. I know it works because I've tried. You just have to make your mind up that you're going to change. Setting your house in order means changing your mindset. Because he said it in Romans, I beseech you, brothers, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice,
holy
and acceptable to God, which is your
reasonable service.
Y'all know the scripture. You've heard it many times. That's part of setting your house in order. Because transformation has to take place. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. It starts up here. In order to set your house in order, you got to start to change your mindset. Your way of thinking has to change. Just as though that guy, well, I won't even go there with him, but our ways of thinking has to change. We've been thinking the same old way. Who said God can operate in the new? Who said that? Who said some of the things you're doing had to be done? Someone said doctrine has made the word of none effect. But God has placed people in your life to help you to set yourself in order. Hallelujah. See, Hezekiah, let me just talk a little bit about him, because I see y'all going away over there to the left. Hezekiah came to the throne in the vigor of his youth, and he, I can say it once again, he was only 25 years old. And he only lived to be, what, 54 years old. So he didn't even make 70. That's the plus the 15 that he had. So 29, 15, all that add, all that up. But here he is, depending on God, trusting God to do, to heal him, and to add to his life. Jesus. Do you trust God? Do you really trust God to do what he says he's going to do? Age does not matter.